inherited the extremely difficult situation, a very bad situation. We knew that the situation would be that good economically, socially, but they're always much bigger than we expected. And we are just sort of digging in now. For example, the debt position itself was not fully disclosed. And we're picking issues around that. We're picking issues in terms of, you know, movements of, you know, cash, which is really not supposed to be the case. But we believe we'll be on top of things very soon in terms of knowing the extent of the damage that has been done. There's a lot of damage.
When you say that some things that are not yet clear, are we talking about corruption?
We're talking about the full extent of the debt, Lupesa, number one, as an example. We're talking about, if you like, the levels of corruption that we are beginning to pick, a lot of illicit, you know, movements of funds that I don't want to preempt things, but what we are picking is horrifying. They're still trying to do things now. And even when we made pronouncements very clear that we want to stabilize the country, people are still trying to make last-minute movements of funds, which are unauthorized, which are not theirs. But we'll get to the bottom of that very soon. Obviously, also, for example, if you look at the size of the payroll, you begin to see that there are a lot of people who are not working, but they're on the payroll, exerting a further burden to the treasury, which is already stressed.
Okay, well, let's turn to those creditor negotiations. It's been stressed that the IMF is going to be one of those organizations that is key to your recovery. Why? And also, how is that going to fit in with the fact that a quarter of Zambia's foreign debt, which stands at £13 billion, is actually held by China and Chinese entities, and they are locked in, which gags Zambia by their highly secretive clauses. That won't sit well with the IMF.
Before we talk about IMF, Kwesa, before we talk about the Chinese, we ourselves, as citizens of Zambia, we ourselves as the government, as a leadership of this new leadership of this country, send a clear message that we're here to do business and serious business. What do I mean? We are here to control frivolous expenditure, to be prudent, to make sure that we understand that resources are scarce and they ought to be utilized in a most optimal manner. That's very, very important for us. Before we can extend a request to anybody to assist us, we must assist. We must help ourselves do better. This is fundamental, and that's who we are. And you already were beginning to show that side of us, that we're different. We come in with the seriousness, we come in with integrity, we come in with, you know, if you like, self-restraint on utilization or accessing public resources. Then we can walk with our heads high to talk to the IMF that we need the support. We're actually not concerned about the IMF so-called conditionalities. Our own minimum requirements are much higher than what the IMF wants. I think that's what the people of Zambia need. They need zero tolerance to corruption, and we're bringing that to the table. Now, China, you talked about China. We are aware of the Chinese debt portfolio. We understand what is going on roughly, and the Chinese are aware that if the economy is not reorganized to bring about growth, their own debt stock is at risk of being paid progress. I mean, this is common sense, but it's for me, this is bread and butter. So they understand that we need to talk. We are talking, we've started the initial stage. They've indicated that we'll cooperate, and I think we are able to do things with them that will help this economy stabilize. We want to develop the country, develop the resource endowment this country has, which you know very well, the minerals, you know, the water resources, the land resources, the paper resources, so that we can grow this economy and make it credible to do business with anyone around the world.
You've made some really swift appointments over the last few days. On social media, it's been described as a purge of the defense forces and the police. Why was this such a high priority for you?
The first appointment we ever made was the Minister of Finance. And he was appointed alone out of maybe a cabinet of, I don't know the number, I don't want to reveal to you clearly, but we made that appointment to send a message that the economy comes first, trade and investment comes first, in our efforts to reconstruct the economy, to reconstruct the social fabric of our people, which can only be funded by a functioning economy. Very important. Okay, to reunite our people, to reunite our country. Then the second aspect is rebuilding the economy, reconstructing the economy, for also to support the social sector. Now, we made the first ministerial announcement with the Minister of Finance. We don't want a single short learning cap. We want to get in business vital. You see our choice of the Bank of Zambia government. So all of this is well orchestrated. Now, the defense forces are part of what we call the importance of keeping peace and stability in our country. Lucrecia, for us to develop the country, to push the economic side of the country, you know, which is in a dilemmatic situation now, we need peace and stability. The defense forces did a very good job in the transition before elections, on the election, around the elections, post elections. There were a lot of temptations, but they did a good job. But we also need another crop to carry on that will ensure we have peace and stability, so we can have an opportunity to focus on the economic agenda.
Okay. All right. Now, Zambia is at an historic moment in its life, and as well as your election, what I'm talking about is your population. You have an historic young demographic. Basically, the country belongs to the youth. They certainly helped you with your election. It does offer, yes, it does offer lots of opportunities, but a huge challenge for you as well. Recently, you put this question yourself. You said, how do you run an economy where the population are largely unskilled? I would now like to add, how do you run an economy where the population are largely unskilled and young?
It's fundamental for us that we address the need of the youth in this country. Proportionately, they are the majority. Therefore, it's important that we understand that they are the key stakeholders, they're the owners of this country. And for them to realize that ownership, they must have opportunity, Lucrecia. But that has to start with skills, education. They have to have education. And a lot of people try and really argue this thing in a very awkward and negative way. You cannot question the importance of educating the young people, because you are questioning the importance of skills in an economy. How can you run an economy without skills? So it goes without saying.
So what are you going to do about it?
We want to offer education for the school-going children.
Free education?
Free education, universal free education. You know, our kinder, primary school, secondary school, that's universal education. Now, when we get to the higher levels, college, Lucrecia, university, then we begin to bring in the factor of, you know, the kids who are most talented.
Yes.
And they are talented, they come from poorer families. But we don't end there. We don't end there, Lucrecia. We are also looking at the artisan skills, the skills that the economy needs, which are in short supply today.
What do you understand as women's issues for your administration and children, those top priorities when it comes to your administration and supporting women and children? In fact, how many women do you have in your cabinet?
Well, the cabinet is not yet constructed fully. It'll happen very soon. Let's see. But unfortunately, the election did not bring so many women into parliament. You know, our system, we draw our cabinet from inside parliament. And that's a restriction. We will be looking at doing something with the constitution that allows us to bring more women through proportional representation. Women, the youth, those that live with disabilities. But that's a few years ahead. But for now, we will do our best to bring women. The anchor of the African society is the woman.
And finally, Mr. President, 25 days until your first national budget for Zambia. The world will be watching. I would like to take you back to the late President Mwanawasa. He transformed the country with his macroeconomic reform, but he said and he admitted that for all the economic growth that he was able to bring to Zambia, he said, one of my failures, and those are his words, one of my failures was that poverty continued. How are you going to ensure that the benefits trickle down to those who need it most?
Devolution is very important. Devolution in decision making, local communities setting their priorities. as to what they want to see first. And what we are doing in the first budget, you will see us taking away money from the center of West and putting it into what we call constituents development fund, direct expenditure to the local area so that decisions can be made there and implemented there in accordance with the local priorities. That is new, because all you had in the past was a paltry amount of money allocated as constituent development fund. We're going to shift now a bit more money, quite a bit more money, so that we can increase economic transactions at the local level. That is fundamental. This is a totally new arrangement which will allow us to focus more, not on consumption expenditure, Professor, but more on investment expenditure for revenue generation, for job, for business opportunity, for poverty reduction. Very important. Very important.
And that was the